Cinema Summit. Good evening and a very warm welcome to you. We're delighted to have you here with us. Please come. And talking to Ekta is the festival director of Jagran Film Festival, renowned, awarded film critic, Mayank Shekhar. Mayank, over to you.
Welcome to the final session. We've had the whole day of talking. One big announcement we made for those who were not there for the last session, that we finally have an opening film for Jagran Film Festival. It's called A Star Is Born. Stars Lady Gaga is gonna sweep the Oscars in 2019, and you'll watch it for the first time in India on the 27th of this month, on the first day of Jagran Film Festival here in Bombay. So I hope, Ekta, to see you there as well. That's a movie that everyone's talking about. We had a long introduction for you, but the way I've known you as a viewer is the way I've known a gentleman called Sergey Bubka. I have never watched Pole Vault, okay? Not too many people in the world have watched Pole Vault. But everybody knows Sergey Bubka. There's one person they all know because he became almost as big as that sport. I don't know the crowd here, but in general, a lot of my friends may not have watched all your TV shows. But there is not one person we know who hasn't heard of Ekta Kapoor. You're almost as big as the medium, a cultural phenomenon by yourself. Question to you is, how did that happen?
So when you said that you're almost as big, I was really checking my weight for 5 seconds. I don't think the keto is helping. But I don't know, you know, I do my job and I think a lot of things are byproducts. So when I started off with television because my father told me that you can't sit at home. So either you get married or start working. Marriage was not an option. So I started working because he was like, I can't see you partying every night and doing what every youngster does who has a lot of means and a lot of financial ease in their life. And he says that ease cannot become the reason or a curse. It can't be a blessing that is a curse, you know. You have to work and earn your living or do something on your own, which is quite an emancipated thought for a Punjabi papa. But yeah. And so I started working. And then he came to me with his offer that a friend of his had told him to make content for a channel in London. So to cut the long story short, that content was made, but the channel got sold and the content was so bad, no one bought it. And let me tell you, most of it was, according to me, revolutionary television, which everyone said that, what are you doing? I mean, who's gonna watch this at home? Luckily, I got a show of mine, which I made with the last bit of money called Hum Paanch, and then I started Balaji Telefilms. And everything else after that was...
The rest is history, isn't it?
I don't know if the rest is history, but the rest is definitely folklore.
Well, it's folklore, it's history also, because the years that you've been in the space has also been the years where we've moved from film to television to OTT, and you've actually been in all three platforms, or all three media, as it were. But what I find most intriguing about you, Ekta, speaking of partying and stuff, and I don't know how many people know this, but they probably do, because if they read, they see pictures and stuff, you are the best host in Bombay. You throw the best parties there are. You're single, you are fun, you are very urbane also, very Juhu girl, Mitti Bhai girl. And then you come up with what would be the Sati Savitri woman, the Parvati woman, the, you know, Sindoor woman. What was your inroad to that world? How did you learn that? To even tap into that market, which is, I would imagine, at least looking at you, would be very divorced from the world you come from. What did you do to actually tap into that market?
So I think I'll answer the first part first, which is...
Which is to invite me to your next party.
Yeah, of course. Okay. Yeah, I always invited you. You've come rarely. So that's another one we'll take offline. But no, the party bit, no. I was saying about how are you so different from these women? And I'm like, we are as different as we are similar or alike. Because I believe that there's this world out there that starts looking at a different kind of person casually. which I have learned to move away from. Acceptance should be the biggest word that we learn. We have failed as a generation to learn the word acceptance. I mean, a woman who wears a sari, who has a different thought process, who wears loads of jewelry, who probably lives a different life, deserves that much respect and insight. And I think I just did that. I think I have as much fun making a nagin without losing respect for the job I do as I have promoting or making a lipstick.
Mm.
And I think that's because we all have different sides to us. When I'm doing nagin, I believe that folklore should be enjoyed, reveled. I mean, it's suspension of reality. It's absolute unabashed entertainment for the masses, and I respect the masses, so I do it with full aplomb. And then when you do something which you think is interesting, thought-provoking, you do that with that thought process. I mean, it's like, I think we have those sides to us, but we are cagey to accept a different thought because we think we are a certain kind of person. And how did I get into this? Yes, when I was young, I didn't live in a new joint family, but I realized the content I was making wasn't going into television because it was different. It was like a little clutter breaking. I decided to make shows on peer pressure and really like, and none of it was getting approved. And I was like, what am I doing?
Mm.
I wanted to do drama, and I realized Indian families sit and eat together. And we as a nation, hamare khane ke daant aur dikhane ke daant hote hain.
Mm.
So what we watch with our parents is going to be very different than what we watch alone.
Mm.
And that's how I decided to realign my thought process and made large, unabashed family dramas.
And you almost also killed the entire genre that existed in cinema, for instance. Like a Hum Aapke Hain Kaun would become redundant once you do kitchen politics on television. Is that what happened?
No, I think experiences change. So films have to live up to the experience that they promise, which is communal viewing. If I'm going with five friends to a theater or with my family to a theater, I need to see what is promised. And I think if that promise is being delivered by TV, I have to just change the promise. So I don't think I killed a genre. I think I somewhere compromised it a bit, but it could have, it metamorphosized into something else and came back.
Right. But you know, you've said this in the past, and I think you've said it's quite often, is that when it comes to content on television, while it allows for progressive content, it does not allow for radical content. Absolutely. What do you mean by that?
So progressive content is that you can have, larger thought processes which are progressive taken into consideration, like women working, yes. I mean, women supporting NGOs, women having a say at home, which at one time was a struggle for women. So it's gotten progressive. You have a story now. I mean, I have not made it. Somebody's made it, called Shakti, which is the first transgender show.
Mm.
And it has worked. That means people are interested in watching even something like transgender, which I don't think any film has done or digital show has done.
Right.
Just now, I mean, their Sacred Games is done, but it was television did 3 years ago.
Right.
And but
Sacred Games is also not theatrical. It's
I'm saying it's still, right. But television, like typical Indian television, did it 3 years ago. We did a show which was about a woman who is in our society called barren. If she can't have a child, and you know, reproduction cannot be the reason you're called incomplete.
Mm.
So we did a show, and it was a non-primetime show, but it took off and it became India's cult show. And India accepted her and accepted that motherhood is nurturing, not nature. And I was in shock because I was like, this is a really big one. Because a year before that, when I had shown a woman who's in a bad marriage, having an issue with her husband who's cheated on her, finally deciding to have an emotional bond.
Mm.
With a colleague, it became an issue because they said, "Marta to nahi hai na, to problem kya hui?" So that's radical. A woman and her sexuality in India is radical, but her career choices, her going ahead and doing something for her family over her in-laws, taking a stand for herself is progressive. So where the progressive gets a little radical, they get skirmish.
Now, when you take television onto an OTT platform, which is not where everyone has to watch it together, does that liberate you as a person who can do radical plus progressive or whatever it is that you want to do?
I feel I'm in a candy store, you know. I mean, people are like, how are you going to manage with all the international players coming in? I'm like, the process is so much fun because in films, I had to actually wait for actors' dates. I did very small films, if you saw, because I couldn't have that, you know, and I was not used to that mindset of actually having dinners, getting to know actors. I mean, now it's a very different, but it was sort of a trend. I didn't know anyone personally.
But contrary, you're from a film family. I mean,
yeah,
you're
contrary to the fact that right. I'm a film family, I spent a lot of time doing television and I lost touch with everyone. But I did films which I actually thought was, this is a relief for me because these are nothing that is expected from me. With digital, I get a space which is far more individualistic. So like, I believe film is communal viewing, TV is family viewing, and individual viewing is digital. I don't have to cater to something that everybody likes. I don't have to make a one-size-fits-all. And I can finally tell stories that I want to tell, and some of it is really like, you know, even a fun, stupid show is fun because it doesn't get you shackled into a thing that, oh, will this be accepted?
So you're saying when television has to deliver to, say, 150 million homes or 150 million people, that's the number which is, you know, way higher than what films need to do, which is roughly around 3 million.
And remember, it's 150 million homes. It's not 150 million people.
Wow.
And 150 million homes means you adopt what I call the home personality. A lot of us, including me, and I'm guilty to say this, will not be comfortable watching a highly sexual scene with my dad in the room. Like, I'd be like, I have no problems. You watch it on your own, and I'll watch it on my own. And it's just the way we are as Indians, maybe, you know. And therefore, TV is, you're going into someone's home. It's like, I don't know which culture, which lifestyle, which mindset I'm getting into. There's a child there. There's a mother there. There's a grandmother there. There are girls there. So you're so careful. And it's almost vanilla, the kind of content you do on TV. And yet you have to get them back every week. So it's like going for a war with your hands and legs tied. On an OTT platform, you have an open space. You know that you're catering to a certain kind of viewer. You know that they have the sensibility to see the promo and watch it alone or with their friends. And they don't have to then. So you have the ability to make content because you know that then the discretion is of the viewer.
But how did you get into the mindset of homes which are so disparate from yours? And when you're talking about such huge numbers, did you use research? Did you use metrics? Did you do surveys?
I never do research. I never do survey. I believe in instinct and one thing which is called, a lot of us have it in us, which is called experience. I mean, I do the same job so many times that at some point I get to know my viewer. And it's an instinct that gets sharpened by experience, you know. So, I mean, I don't do research because I believe research is postmortem. They will find an old show and say, this is what the research said. But I rather go with instinct. I actually believe you have to know that what the viewer is not saying and would probably want. So, research will never tell you that.
So, Nagin was instinct?
Yeah, it was.
It came in your dream?
It came in my dream. Actually, I wanted to make it after Dhoti picture, by the way.
Oh, really?
I really wanted to. I think I went to a very big actress and I told her, I want to make Nagin. She said, India's going to watch Nagin. Like, are you like for real? I said, yeah. But are you serious? India's going to watch Nagin? I said, I'm telling you, India will watch Nagin. India loves folklore. It has never seen its own folklore on celluloid. I mean, after years.
Right, right. The genre almost like became non-existent in cinema.
Yeah, celluloid. But it, I said, well, then when I got this no one, I was like, I'm not going to go and convince people. I said, I'll make it a TV show. And I went to Colors. I said, I want to make Nagin. They said, okay. Yeah, go make it. I said, fine, let's go and make it. And it happened.
That's because they love you, right? I mean, yeah, you do something, it becomes success.
I don't know if they love me, but I just thought that India should just, I mean, we have folklore in our country. And I don't want to run away from it or get shy about it. It's pretty interesting. We have our own shapeshifters. We have our own Draculas. And they call Nagins.
But for you, as personally, as a creative person, Ekta, you've grown up with your father, his cinema.
That's why I watched Nagin. He was in Nagin.
So that's what I was getting at. Was there a huge influence of the stuff he did in the 80s in your television as well?
Yeah. a lot of influence of his 80s movies. A lot of influence of a lot of things I saw in the 80s. Of course, my favorite movies were Ramses. I think I watch all of them. But I think, I think a lot of movies, not only my dad's, but Mr. Bachchan's in the 80s influenced my mindset, and I thought that's what the masses will always want.
Did you love the 80s Bollywood?
Not really. I think I preferred the 90s and the Adi Chopra era. But right. Yeah, I didn't mind it, you know.
Right. But the reason why I'm asking this question is also because when you do television, when you have to appeal to that many people, which is very different from what you'll do what you are doing in OTT, because these are the early adopters of the medium.
Yeah.
They're using it right now. Of course, it'll have that depth and it'll get that reach eventually. It's a matter of time. There's stuff that you've done on television which you can easily adapt to OTT because this OTT crowd has not seen your stuff. Is there a temptation to remodel what you've done for a new audience?
I think yeah and no also. I have so much I have not done because I couldn't do it on TV that I actually want to do that first. But yeah, if there's a great story that I can remodel, and like Manmarziya was a great example. They took a very quintessential
story, and
did it in today's context. So I'd love to do that. But at this present moment, there are many stories to be told, which I'm dying to tell.
How many stories you're dying to tell? Okay, at any point in time, how many shows of yours, or how many things, whether they're shows on OTT, TV, perhaps even films, are in pre-production, in production, or in post, at any point in time?
So I have about 30 shows on the OTT platform that I'm working on.
30 shows right now,
five
as we
films
speak.
And about 10 dailies on air at this moment.
Guys, I'm sorry. What did you do today? How many hours did you work? Are you a workaholic? Do you work 20 hours a day?
I'm actually, you know, I don't have many hobbies. I started working when I was 17. So I look at people who say, like, when we go for a holiday, you know, it's like, don't you want a holiday? I don't know anything else. I was a couch potato before that. I only watched television. That was my enjoyment, which is clearly killed because now I can't watch television for enjoyment. I mean...
Yeah, but you're a Narcos fan.
I'm a Narcos fan. I'm actually, at this present moment, indulging in a lot of The Fall. I think it's a fantastic show that I just caught up with.
The reason why I know you're a Narcos fan is because I read a quote of yours where you said, on your OTT platform, you want to go from Nagin to Narcos. I think it's a fantastic line. Is that what you're going to do?
See, I think with individualistic taste, we have a world out there. Everyone is going to have their own kind of entertainment. Their own mobile is going to decide what they want to watch. And they might want to watch both, Nagin and Narcos. Or they might want to watch what is the world between Nagin and Narcos. And they might want to watch a really cheesy soap opera. And they might want to watch a really thrilling, edge of the seat thriller. And that's the choice you will have to watch what you want. So I think it's a world out there. And it is going to skim from Nagin to Narcos.
But tell me something, like back, like say maybe 8-9 years ago, not even that far back, perhaps even less than that, you would pay say 150 rupees and get a cable connection and you could watch everything. Now there is Netflix, there is Amazon, there is Alt Balaji, there is Z5, there is Eros, there is Disney that's coming up with this app. Technically speaking, how much do you think a person can actually invest in their monthly entertainment? Do you think there'll be a shakeout with so many players in the market?
Of course there'll be a shakeout, but let's not talk about the financial investment because that everyone will realign as and when they realize the economics of the game. Let's say a lot of people watch, say, Sacred Games. The first question you ask them, they would say they watched it in a night or maximum a weekend. That gives any maker a lot of relief because there are 52 weekends left.